Hello, and thank you for tuning in to the Final Draft Write On podcast. I'm Pete D'Alessandro, your host and product manager here at Final Draft. This is the screenwriting podcast where we talk about all things filmmaking. Today, we'll be talking to Big Break Contest winners Jeff Cassidy and Myles Reid. And right now, I'm going to take us to Kayla Guess, who's not only the producer of this podcast, but also the director of the Big Break Contest. Thanks, Kayla.
Hey, Pete. I'm excited to have both of our winners, Jeff and Myles, here today. So we just wrapped up a very busy, busy time for them.
So what's going on with them? I mean, they win the Big Break Contest, and then what do they get out of that? What happens next?
We determine, you know, if they're not living in Los Angeles, we fly our winners in. We take care of their flight and their hotel. We have a luncheon with the judges of the Big Break Contest at Boa Steakhouse in West Hollywood, where basically it's an ask me anything to 16 to 20 judges, depending on, you know, who's available for our winner. So they can ask them every question under the sun they can possibly have about securing representation. We have them meet with our previous year's Big Break winners just to kind of get a little brief on how to capitalize on their win. We then take them to our award show at Paramount Studios, where we introduce them to the industry on stage, make them give speeches that they don't want to give, and they get to be honored on stage alongside professional screenwriters. This year, for example, we had Boots Riley on stage, we had Tanya Sirocco, we had Callie Corey, and they got to share a stage with those industry professionals. After the award show, we took them on a water bottle tour to meet with some literary managers.
Well, just for people who don't know, tell us what the water bottle tour is.
It's kind of, I guess that's a inside jargon. It's basically general meetings in the industry. And every time you walk into a new meeting, you're offered a bottle of water or coffee or whatever. But the jargon is water bottle tour. So yeah, so we take them on this tour, and that looks like general meetings with several firms. This year we had five different firms meet with our winners. We met with Brillstein, with Kaylee Marsh and Natalie Kovalt. Then we moved on to Bellevue to see our friends Jeff Portnoy, John Zauzerny, and Zach Zucker. Then we moved on to lunch with Sonia Gambaro over at Pollinate, and we moved on to Heroes and Villains. We met with Marcus Gorg and Chris Coggins, and then we ended that day back down in Beverly Hills at Echo Lake to meet with Chelsea Benson.
It sounds like a nice big roster. I mean, that's a real set of general meetings.
We're very grateful for their time. I mean, listen, we understand that their time is literally their money. So to meet with our winners and just to give their insight and to pour their wisdom into them.
That's great.
Finally, we brought them over here to do their podcast interviews and find out more about them as writers.
Let's go to that right now. Well, here's our interview with Jeff Cassidy. Jeff Cassidy, welcome to Write On.
Hey, thanks very much. You have a great voice.
Thank you. So do you.
Oh, thanks.
Yes, you have all this great stuff happening, but you still submit to Big Break. So why get that? Why was that important to you?
I feel like it's a multi-tiered answer, and I don't. You know, we'll see if I can answer it. Basically, I was, you know, I had written a couple things in development and working on directing and everything like that, and everything was kind of in a certain space. We'll call it. The script I'm writing now is kind of Amblin-y in tone. You know, a commercial filmmaking landscape. And I had this idea for Daisy's story, and it sort of channeled some of the films I loved as a kid, like Leon, The Professional, or whatever you want to call it. Leon, some people call it, but French title, Leon, that's the name of the film. I don't know. And Road to Perdition was another one that was a big influence on that one. And I kind of wanted to do this, like, unlikely duo paired up on this, like, just a really simple quest for revenge in a really cool environment. And you know, I wrote it, and it was just out of the box from some of the other. Everyone likes to put you in a box, you know what right. I mean? Especially in this industry. And it was out of the box, and I didn't really know what was going to happen. I had talked to my team, and they didn't really know what was going to happen. I was like, you know, on a whim, I was like, screw, I submitted to one contest. It was Final Draft. I was like, if I'm going to do it, it might as well be the right contest, because I feel like, you know, there's probably a lot of wrong contests out there. And I just wanted to make sure it was legit. I wanted to see, you know, if anyone genuinely liked it, or me, and you just kind of see what would happen. I, you know, it feels like some people liked it.
Apparently, yeah. Apparently, they did. You got through a large pool. You got through a large pool of applicants. So, yeah, obviously, somebody liked it.
Yeah. So, you know, ultimately, the Final Draft has these amazing prizes and everything like this. But like, all I wanted to do is see if people liked it, get some eyes on it, and hopefully, this is the inciting incident to its own story, propels this thing to get made.
Yeah, so now you're really looking at being a writer-director. I mean, you've got a foot in each world going forward.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
So what do you have to concentrate on?
J.J. Abrams, look out. Here I come.
All right.
Why is everyone laughing?
We'll let J.J. know. So what's going to be next? You're going to have this episode. I mean, obviously, there's going to be some weeks of prep when you get up to Vancouver, and then there's going to be shooting, and then will you be there for post?
So a week and a half of prep in Vancouver. We shoot for 8 days, come back to L.A. for post, four days of editing, and then that's it. They kick me to the curb.
Wow. What are you going to be thinking about this first time? What's going into this first job, this first gig, this first TV episode gig?
I am hoping to, you know, TV's a tough beast. It's like, you know, schedule before art a lot of the times. I just really want to go in there and make, you know, make something that is, I guess it'll sound cheesy, but make something special. You know, I want to make it, I want to add scope to it. I have a few ideas where actually, having worked on the show before too, you're like, oh, I wish we could do that today, or I wish we could do that, or wouldn't it be great if we did this instead of this? Because, you know, ultimately, storytelling, whether it's directing, writing, whatever it is like subjective at the end of the day. So if you're a storyteller, you're probably, and you're on a film set, you're probably there with your own idea of how you could tell that story. So I'm hoping to go in there and just make something that's ultimately, you know, a moving episode of TV that has some scope and some fun for people to watch it.
How much, on The Flash, how much do they balance kind of the director's autonomy with, you know, the writer's and the showrunner's autonomy?
In TV, the showrunner is God. It's, you know, you can tell just by, you know, every writer in TV is a producer in some capacity. They're the boss at the end of the day. But, and, you know, this may depend on what show you're on. I have seen this with other people, and I've already seen it with me. They're super supportive. Todd Helbing's like an amazing, real human being. You know, it's not carte blanche. There's a budget, and there's a schedule, and there's time, and there's actors' schedules, and, you know, all this stuff. But they're super supportive in trying to, you know, not deliver a cookie-cutter episode of TV. They're flat, you know, on Flash, they're doing cool shit all the time. They're literally, like, blowing stuff up, and they have stuntmen on wires being propelled into the air, and car chases, and, like, all the cool stuff that, like, when you sat in a theater as a kid, or now you can see on television all the time. All that cool stuff they're doing on a daily basis. So all the tools and toys and great personalities and amazing, like an amazing cast and everything like that, it's all there. So just go in, shake that up, see what comes out.
Right. I think there's something I'm realizing here that you've worked on a show like this. How many years were you on Flash?
So one of the DPs was a friend of mine going into, he's not there anymore, but he called me up and he said, I'm going to go do this show called The Flash, and I want you to do it. I said, look, you know me, for years now I've been like procrastinating going full time into writing and directing, and I've made the decision. I've done my last show already. I was working a couple days a week on Warcraft and as a focus puller, and I was like, this is great. What a great huge massive show to go out on. And he was like, well, What do you want? We'll give you more money. And I was like, I don't care about that. And he's like, well, what else do you want? You want to write and direct? You just need time, right? And I was like, yeah. He's like, well, what if you did every second episode? And I was like, let me think about that. So I did every second episode of the first season of Flash. Hmm. And at that time, I was dating my now wife. Halfway through the season, I met her. So I would do like 2 weeks in Vancouver working on The Flash as an operator or focus puller, and then 2 weeks in LA, and I would just be writing. Like, I just wrote every day, and alternated episodes, whole first season, then I went back and operated like sporadically when I happened to be in Canada or whatever it was on the second season. I think that's how that worked, if I remember correctly.
Does that dovetail with the other work you've written?
Depends who you talk to. For me, everything that I respond to or I'm excited about writing is related to some aspect of family, whether it's a son and his father or a mother and her son or her daughter or two people that aren't even related, but they're, you know, forced, like in Daisy's story, they're forced on a journey, and it's kind of like a father-daughter journey in a lot of aspects. So I'm always kind of interested in, like, stories that have that at the root of it, because I feel like I just respond to it on a personal level, and I feel like it's universal in a way that we can all, like, whether you drop that into an action movie or a thriller or, you know, whatever it is, it gives us something to relate to.
Yeah, absolutely. I wanted to ask quickly about, just can you get us the synopsis of Daisy's story, and that was the contest-winning script.
So yeah.
What was that, and where did the germ of the idea come from?
Daisy's story is about a 12-year-old girl who lives on a ranch with her parents in 1867, and her parents get murdered, and she's this smart, precocious kid who, like, always wanted to grow up well beyond her time type thing. And she somehow manages to convince the ranch hand that she doesn't know too much about. She manages to convince this guy to go off on a quest for revenge into the mountains and track down the killer. It was, like I was sort of speaking to earlier, it was almost an homage to, like, a lot of those movies that I loved growing up, some of my favorite movies. And I didn't look at it as a Western or, you know, on the surface of as a film about race or anything like that, that the ranch hand's African-American, she's 12-year-old Caucasian. I was just like, how cool is it to have these two characters who are completely different in every, like, physical and emotional, every, you know, in every way, but they, like, they're also the same in a lot of ways, too. They're like a, you know, walking juxtaposition or dichotomy or whatever you want to call it. And it becomes Bo, the ranch hand, it becomes his job to make sure that Daisy's life doesn't end up in the direction that his life ended up in. So I just thought it was a really heartfelt, cool story that I needed to write, even if it was outside of the space that I'd been writing in.
That's great. So what was it like when you won Big Break? What happened, and what did you take away from that?
Well, as I said in my speech, in all the fine print on the website, they don't tell you you have to give a speech when you win. So it was super exciting, great night. Not super fond of speaking in front of 500-600 people, but it was, you know, it was awesome. There's a, you know, there's, like I said, 500-600 people of your peers and some, like, there were some really awesome writers that were being awarded that night that I, you know, just to be in the same room is an honor, and I got to receive the award in front of them. And then since then, final draft's been amazing. They've taken they took me and Myles, the winner of the pilot category, and we went out to an amazing lunch, and there was 15, 16 managers or something like that there, and we got to meet each one and tell our story and hear their story. And then days after, we toured the town. We went to all the different management companies and met, you know, a whole bunch of really cool people. And I couldn't help thinking the whole time is, like, had I done this 15 years ago or something like that, if I didn't have representation, especially, this would be the thing that really takes you from writing a script to you're in the middle of the industry now, and this sky's the limit.
Right. It feels like you made that transition from I'm writing to I'm starting a career.
100%, yes. Yeah, exactly.
Thanks, Jeff Cassidy, for being on the podcast.
What an interesting perspective, someone entering the contest to basically get the temperature of a script that everyone told him not to write.
I think that's a really fascinating thing that he did with that, and he made something happen. So here's our other interview with Myles Reid. He'll be talking to us today about his winning script, Scattershot. Myles Reid, welcome to Write On.
Thanks for having me, Pete.
Let's get into Scattershot. So where did the idea for Scattershot come from? When did this start?
Scattershot was born out of it's fictional, but it comes from, it's influenced by the experiences I had growing up in a small town in Maryland, places called Salisbury. Think of it as a small town surrounded by smaller towns. Essentially, it's the biggest thing around, but you got to go two hours in any direction before you get to another decent-sized thing like Baltimore, D.C. The script, it follows a game warden on the last day of hunting season, buck hunting season. There are different hunting seasons. And he just essentially has the most momentous day of his life. And at the end of it, which I play with chronology, so actually it's at the beginning, he's shot on his own front lawn. And the idea of the season is that we're going to return to the same day as we've already seen, but view it from perspectives of different characters. As a result, we're going to get more answers of all these questions that have raised. Someone was angry at the church in this pilot, and then in episode 3, we're going to see their story and be like, oh, he's angry because this happened. And all the while, as we're kind of gathering and getting a fuller concept of the town, we're getting pulled forward by this question of like, well, but who shot the game warden?
So do you get some notes at some point on that? Because that seems one of those kind of cliches is, well, I don't know where the second episode goes, the end of this pilot. So how do you, when you all you have is a script to rely on, especially in a contest, how do you write that so that people understand what's going to happen in episode 2?
Yeah, that's a great point. I leaned into action description. And this is something that some people tell you not to do, but I think in this case you definitely had to. And I think I've heard from a lot of people whose opinions I respect very much. And they said, no, lean into the action description. Tell the audience what they need to hear. If you're hoping that they infer something, you may be losing a lot of people. So I would mention, essentially, I think there are a few lines in there that were like indicative of a sort of question. And then I would actually put like, but that's a question for another episode. And I think somewhere in the teaser, I do say that this is a pilot that covers many. This is a television show that covers many stories. This one is Morrison's. The character's and the pilot's name is Morrison. But we will be seeing from others' eyes.
That's really interesting because I think a lot of that, you know, that would depend on a pitch to make sure that we get that across in a less tested script.
Yeah.
You obviously figured out to nail that from the beginning.
Yeah, well, I'm still debating whether I throw in essentially what would be the teaser from episode 2 at the end of this, which sort of waking up in the shoes of the next character, which I don't have in there, but it's not too late. And yeah, it's never too late to second guess yourself either. No amount of like pat on the shoulder can convince you that you're done working on it.
Yes, it's true. Once it's out, it'll be done and never before.
I mean, I had a screenwriting professor who said like it was done when they pulled it from my hands. And then not even then. I was like, no, it's not done. So yeah.
So what was the process in coming up with this? How did the writing process work for you on this?
It started with the concept of seeing one story from a variety of perspectives. And then that was like the first big, the word I want to use is, I don't know, it's like something that supports you. I don't have my metaphor down, but that was the first big step. Second big step was realizing that I could base it off my own experiences, which pretty much whenever you're trying to break in, everyone is telling you that you should write what you know and write based on stuff you know or write something that introduces you. So I thought I could, I think part of my, one of my problems in coming up in this industry is that I think that my backstory is a little more plain, perhaps, than I'd like. And so here was a way that I could take a world that I grew up in that I see as kind of plain because I've known it for decades, and then kind of revisit it through different eyes and also kind of use a larger-than-life device to see it. Because actually, another thing that happens in the pilot is you kind of keep on bouncing through chronologies. You're going from the day to the investigation and back and forth, and we actually speed through space and time to transition, which I did because I thought it was taking something that was, I hate this word for it, it's not quite right, but a little mundane, small, Americana, pastoral, and then kind of treating it with the biggest, brightest brush that I could. Wow. Which is kind of how I think those people's stories feel to the people that they're happening to. But sometimes they're not stories that we see or get romanticized that much.
Well, let's get into how Big Break worked for you. You won very recently now. So What was it like when you won Big Break? I mean, you got on stage, you had a speech, but really what did the contest open up for you so far?
So much. I couldn't believe the level of access that Final Draft Big Break gave me. It was really incredible. First of all, because I didn't have the expectations for what would necessarily come out of this. I didn't know or even know what to believe, because sometimes you can, you know, you can read a prize package online or something and be like, oh, okay, sure, this is what you're going to get. But in this case, I got everything promised and more. I could not believe how many people I was connected with within a week. Wow. First of all, just within my own circle, how many congratulations I got, what a big deal it was within other writers I knew in the industry, and just how many new friends I've made, both by people that the contest has put me in touch with, and then just through the contest sort of forms a circle there of other applicants, other people who are connected to the contest in some way. And I've found that it's a very giving circle, that it's a lot of people out there who are happy to meet you and talk and read your script or you read their script. And just, I think a big part of trying to work in this industry is having a circle of people who have your back, who can submit you for something, who can tell you if a draft's not very good. And I feel like my circle got way bigger as a result of this contest.
What was your process like before? Were you always kind of sending a draft to that group of friends, that close circle?
Yeah, my main rule was that among my friend readers, I would only ever have anyone read a draft once. So I had some readers who they would read the outline, and I feel the worst for those readers, because I don't think outlines are fun for anyone to read. I had first draft people, second draft people, third draft people, and a few very close loved ones would get a couple of these reads, but in general, I would reach out to different people just so I could have new takes. Actually, this kind of reminds me of Jordan Peele has a story that when he was writing Get Out, he had anyone and everyone read his script. Just people who had no connection to the industry, and he would listen to their notes, just because it's, you know, a reaction is a reaction. How something strikes someone. We're all here to be entertained. So even if you don't write scripts or if you've never read a script, the opinion is valid. So I almost always submit to people who do a lot of reading and writing. I don't know, the power of people's opinions, it's a real thing.
Yeah, I mean, it's all subjective, so the number of subjective opinions you get starts to paint a picture eventually.
Sure, you can play by numbers there. If you send it to five people and four people said, I don't like this protagonist, then that protagonist probably needs some changes.
Yes, probably. Let's get into a little bit more about, you know, that water bottle tour, mm-hmm. Final draft. You win. You have seen kind of the other side of talent management. Mm-hmm. Now you're face-to-face with lit managers. Does that give you any new perspective on, are you seeing them through your eyes to some extent? And
I was able to have a lot of conversations with managers. Like, it wasn't the first thing I wanted to talk about, that I work in management, but it was something that inevitably, especially I was in a lot of situations where there were several managers around each other talking about management, that it actually felt like, oh, I could jump in on this. Let's see. They're alike and different, the talent management and the lit management, but it did feel like we could sort of trade stories about, like, oh, have you ever been fired? Well, I mean, that goes without saying. it wasn't like how often you get fired was really, and you know, where do you find clients? And it was interesting to be able to be there as a writer looking for representation, and then also as someone who works in management with talking to other managers. Oh, I got to play both sides.
It just feels like you kind of bring an unfair perspective in that meeting. No one's expecting you to know quite as much as you know.
There are still differences between talent and lit, and so I think I always want to learn more. So in my perspective, I know something. There's always more for me to learn.
Sure. So what else are you working on now? You've got Scattershot is done-ish.
Oh, I've got a little touch-ups, okay, that I'm actually tossing on, and there's always, but yeah, done-ish is perfect.
Okay,
yeah.
All right. So you're starting another script. Do you kind of multitask?
Oh yeah, I always have to have two scripts essentially, and the idea is to have them at different stages. So you're outlining one when you're on draft two or three of another, so that way you can procrastinate productively, where you're like, I don't want to work on that anymore. I don't know what to do. I'm scared. Oh, this one over here is a, can I curse? Yes. I don't know what the rules are. Yes. This one over here is a piece of shit. I know exactly how to fix this one, or I know a bunch of things I could try on this one. And then, oh, after working on that early draft of something, I can go to the one that's farther along. I learned it. There's always steps where they say that your brain just works on stuff, like when you're sleeping. As long as you're kind of keeping it present, you can work on something, even if you're not actively thinking about it. And I often find that the getting up away from the desk and returning, suddenly I have a new idea.
Wow. So. You've pretty much described my exact writing process.
Yeah? Oh, the getting up away from the desk?
And you got to, the back and forth and the deliberate procrastination that helps.
Mm-hmm. Aaron Sorkin says he takes like 10 showers a day when he's really in the thick of it. Sometimes I get it with driving. There's good activities where you're doing something, but your brain is not full.
Right.
Your brain is free to think of whatever, but there's nothing that's expected of your hands or your other brain. I don't know. So you can, I'm driving. Oh, I'm taking a shower. But you can essentially think about writing without the pressure of having to write.
Yes, right. They don't have to put any ink on a page, and all of a sudden, a lot of stuff comes to you.
Mm-hmm. I go rollerblading right now, which is unusual, apparently. But I haven't seen anyone else out there doing it. But if you catch me in Atwater, sometimes I'm thinking about scripts.
Rolling around
with
your outline in your hand.
with my iPhone in my ears.
That's definitely a neat way to kind of get your head into something else and find that different headspace to get back into that story and to stay in that story.
Mm-hmm.
What's the biggest challenge you ran into with writing Scattershot?
Wow.
Story-wise or process-wise or anything?
The one that comes to mind I've already touched on, which is that it was hard to continue returning to it in successive drafts. That at a certain point, I thought, that's pretty good. That's pretty good. I like a lot of it. People like a lot of it. There are certainly parts, probably four-fifths of the way through my process, where I could have said, all right, good enough, next. But talking to readers and thinking about it more, I felt I wasn't done yet. And I think that just making it that extra, I don't even know, 5% better makes it essentially stand out in a way that it wouldn't have before. So
yes, that 5% makes all the difference, right?
Yeah, because you're competing essentially against, I don't even know, but to get people's attentions, to get readers' attentions, especially in the industry, you're competing against all these people who are very good writers. And so that 5% is the difference between being part of the pack and being above the pack. And I'm certainly not trying to say I'm above the pack, but I'm trying to be.
Trying to be, right. Yeah. And that is a high, high bar to reach.
Mm-hmm. And sometimes you can't quite see it or believe it's there, but you got to keep on reaching.
Yeah. So what are the other sort of recent developments you've had? I mean, who are you working with that's been helping you? How are things working for you as a writer at this point?
The contest put me in touch with Lee Jessup, who's a career counselor in Los Angeles. It's funny because just like 2 years ago, and I haven't told her this, I was looking around for how do I break in? How do I get into this industry? Get farther. We're all looking for that. Through Amazon, I saw her book, and there were no other books like it. And I got it and read it, and it was great. And then now she's a person that I have in my phone. And that's something that I didn't expect or see. Although the funny thing about the contest is it also reminds me of how much power I have. She's a person who exists in the same town that I exist in, and I'm trying to write, and she's trying to help people who are writing. So actually, although the contest has provided me a great platform where I got to meet her, I've also realized that it's I could take these initiatives myself, that you don't have to rely on someone else telling you, now you can do this. Sometimes you have to take that mantle for yourself. But she's been incredible. She knows so many people in the industry. She has worked with so many writers. She knows the process. She knows the struggle. And she's just able to help. And in an expedient and direct way where we don't have to waste time. We just can go straight to this is what's going on. This is what has worked for clients in the past. This is what I see for you. Think about it. And it's okay, great. It's just great to have a resource like that.
Right, someone kind of look and see you from outside your own body and then
It is. Give me some guidance. And that's part of what I'm very interested in as a writer is perspectives. And it's certainly what I touch on in Scattershot. And I think that that's almost something that that's a path we all, if we're so lucky, get to take of like trying to actually see ourselves for who we are, not who we want to be. Mm. And yeah, see ourselves outside our own body. Yeah, that resounds to me a lot. That's I'm always trying to be more frank and honest about that.
So what else have you learned as a writer? Here you are. Obviously, people are liking your stuff that we've established. So what have you learned as a writer now that you wish you'd known earlier? What are the tricks? What are the tips?
Well, it's funny because the advice that any advice that I think of, I always think, oh, but don't say that. Everyone knows that. And I have to remind myself that, oh, wait, no, well, you studied like screenwriting for 3 years and like you have, your experience is not everyone's experience. And it touches on just what I was talking about to you before, which is that I am looking at this world through my own perspective. And even though I'm trying my hardest to consider other perspectives, my natural mode is still like, I am myself. And everyone else out there is me too, right? It's like I'm in this solipsistic being John Malkovich world. So the advice that I'm long-windedly getting to is that they have to write. That there's so many people I've known who talk about writing and think about writing and have a thing they wrote 5 years ago, but the industry is based on writing and continuing to write and having new drafts. I was just talking to a manager the other day, and they said for their clients that aren't working, they want 2 features and 2 TV pilots a year. And I was like, oh, wow, that is quite a bit. And then I was like, but yeah, if you're really trying, that's the evidence that you're trying. If you want people to believe in you, you have to be able to prove that you are trying.
I think so. What's your pace like on your own? Like, what do you feel you crank out? How long does a feature take? How long does a pilot take?
Let's see. Okay. Well, unfortunately, it varies. I wish every year I kind of write out goals, and then every year I hit 3/4 of them. And I think that's about right. It keeps me always thinking, why aren't you better? But as long as that voice isn't too loud that it stops you from working, it's not that bad. My pace tends to be like, I give myself a week and a half for researching. I give myself 2 weeks or so for like, I do a progression of outlines. I do like, here's the idea, here's 1 page of outline, here's the five page outline, here's the getting close to 20 page outline, then go to the first draft. First draft is like, 2 to 3 weeks. It should be 2. It ends up being 3. This is for pilot. And the farther along we get on the process, the less tested it is. So just, I hope to finish a pilot, let's say, every 3 months, and then a feature would take, let's say, 5 months. But the fun of it is that doesn't, just because I'm working on one thing doesn't preclude me from working on the other. And so I could be doing a pilot, you know, on month 4 of a feature while on month 2 of a pilot.
Right.
And as I mentioned before, that can help quite a bit.
Yeah, and I think, does that give you a chance to kind of get those notes from people and wait for those notes to come back?
Yeah, because it could take people a week to read something, and that's that with them being pretty nice. It could take 2 weeks or 3 weeks, yeah. So what you get the opportunity of never stopping in your work, which I think is really important, because if you stop in your work, you then have to convince yourself to start again. So, which, as I've mentioned, can be difficult, can be psychologically taxing. So better not to give yourself that opportunity to opt out and just go from one thing, be like, oh, okay, I'm done with pilot. I'm sending pilot out. I'm working on feature now. And then maybe if I'm really good, I'll be done with feature by the time notes come back from pilot. That's the dream. Obviously, the dream doesn't always pan out, but as long as you're pushing towards the dream, I think you're doing pretty good.
Right. If you can get 3/4 of those goals, like you said, you're doing really well. And then you're always pushing yourself to strive for more.
Well enough. But well enough is always, yeah, exactly. Strive harder. Yeah. I don't know. Sometimes I question that voice. It's like, do you need the voice telling you harder, faster? Is that where, you know, creativity, does that where work comes out of? I think it's, this is essentially the theme of Whiplash, which is also the theme of like Kobe Bryant or like a lot of athletes of like, if you push yourself hard enough, you will get somewhere great. And then the question of Whiplash is like, well, is pushing yourself really, really, really hard, is that worth it? And Whiplash seems to suggest that it is worth it, which is, I don't know, I think it's a larger conversation.
We'll have that interview with Charlie Parker, and then we'll get into Whiplash.
Oh, yeah, exactly.
Well, Myles Reid, thank you so much for being here with us.
Thanks for having me.
And thank you to producer Kayla Guest for being here as well. If you're considering entering Big Break, follow us on social media. We are at Final Draft Inc. on Twitter, and on Instagram, we are at Final Draft Screenwriting. Big Break is going into its 20-year anniversary contest, so check that out. Follow us on social media for dates and details. Until next time, write on.